Suaete omnes. Today I'm talking about Tarquinius Superbus, the seventh and last king of Rome. Remember Servius Tullius. Servius Tullius was the last king of Rome to rule in accordance with humanity and justice. He was mild and moderate, and some writers say that he was willing to abdicate the throne in favor of republican government. However, treachery within his family circle prevented this. Tarquin refused to give Servius the rite of burial and said in jest that Romulus had not been buried as well. He executed leading senators who supported Servius. He employed bodyguards, being fully aware of how he usurped the throne. Without any legal claim to the throne, he could only rule with fear. He began trying capital cases without consultation and by his own authority. He punished with death, exile, or confiscation of property men he thought were guilty, disliked, or just wanted their property. The number of senators were reduced by this procedure and not replaced with new appointments. Tarquin was the first king to break the established tradition of consulting the Senate on all matters of public business and to govern by the mere authority of himself and his household. In questions of war and peace, Tarquin was the sole master. Tarquin made efforts to win the friendship of the Latins in order that his influence abroad would give him greater security at home. He married his daughter to Octavius Mamlius of Tusculum, who was a very distinguished Latin noble who is said to have descended from a child of Ulysses and Circe. Grova Ferentia. Tarquin now had great influence over the Latin nobles, and he called a meeting to discuss common interests at the Grova Ferentia. On an appointed date, a great number of Latins assembled at dawn. However, Tarquin did not make an appearance until just before sunset. All day the Latins waited and discussed many things. Turnus Herdonius of Arica was very upset about Tarquin being late and went on a huge rant. It was a seriously big league rant. Turnus was known as a troublemaker and was full flow of eloquence when Tarquin appeared. He was talking about how he was called Superbus, the proud, how he didn't care about the Latins. He just kept them waiting all day. He didn't value them. You know, he said, well, the Romans don't even like him, all these things. Tarquin said he was late because he had to settle a dispute between a father and a son. Turnus told Tarquin that was the easiest dispute to settle because all that needed to be said was that the son needs to listen to the father, and the son just needs to do what the father tells him. Tarquin said the meeting would have to wait till tomorrow. Tarquin was very disturbed by this incident and thought of a way to promptly get rid of Turnus. It would be in his political interest to make the Latins fear him, but he was not in a position to openly execute Turnus. He bribed slaves to hide weapons in Turnus's house. He then told the Latins that Turnus was planning a revolt and took them to Turnus's house to show them the weapons. Turnus was convinced without a chance of defending himself and bound with stones and thrown in a pool of water in a grove, a new form of punishment invented by Tarquin. The Latins were now afraid of Tarquin and did not dare oppose him. The Romans and the Latins revised the treaty in the Romans' favor. He then reorganized the army, mixing Roman and Latin troops and putting Roman commanders in charge of each company. He then started a 200-year war with the Volscians. Tarquin proved to be an able military commander and added to the riches of Rome. There was one city, however, that gave Tarquin problems, the town of Gabii. The town of Gabii turned out to be more difficult than expected in this war and was able to stop the Romans from taking it over. Tarquin pretended in the hostilities toward the town of Gabii. He then sent his youngest of three sons, Sextus, to Gabii, pretending to have been a fugitive running away from his tyrannical father. Sextus showed up in front of the town and said, "My father's trying to kill me. I need help. I'll tell you everything I know. I will be the best person. Give me a chance." And the citizens of Gabii said, "Okay." Sextus soon was able to ingratiate himself into the town of Gabii. He proved to be an able statesman and military commander. Somehow, every time he fought a Roman army or a Roman group, they would win. Interesting. Once, since Sextus did so well, they even put him in charge of the military of the town of Gabii. Once Sextus had established himself in the town of Gabii, he sent a messenger to his father for instructions. When the messenger arrived in Rome and asked Tarquin what Sextus should do, Tarquin, not trusting the messenger, said nothing but proceeded out to the garden where he began to knock off the heads of poppies with a stick. The messenger did not know what this meant, but went back to Sextus and told him what his father had done. Sextus knew the meaning of the message and began to eliminate influential people from Gabii, some by public trial and others by assassination. Soon, the Tarquins were in control and Gabii lost its independence. Signs looking good for Rome. Tarquin began building a massive temple to Jupiter on the Capitoline Hill, and the Romans had to secularize other temples to make room. They basically had to make temples not temples anymore because the temple was so big. Auguries were taken and all the shrines were able to be secularized except the shrine of Terminus. This was a great sign of the stability and permanence of Rome because the shrine of Terminus was a shrine of endings. And so you can't move the shrine, so that means there's going to be no ending to Rome. On top of the good augury, another great omen was discovered. A workman digging the foundations of the temple found a human head with all his features intact. This meant without any doubt that on the spot would stand the imperial citadel of the capital of the world. Tarquin also employed the people on massive public works projects. Tarquin's view was an idle proletariat was a burden on the state. He built tiers of seating in the circus as well as excavation of the Cloaca Maxima and put the sewer pipe underground. Tarquin needed more money for his public works and he decided to attack the town of Ardea. The assault failed and the Romans had to besiege the city. One night during the siege, the young officers, including Sextus Tarquinius and a man named Collatinus, got together and did a lot of drinking. The men were boasting about who had the best wife. The men decided to settle the boast by riding back to Rome and seeing the wives for themselves. When they got to Rome, all the officers except for Collatinus found their wives enjoying themselves at a lavish dinner party. Collatinus's wife, Lucretia, was at home weaving with her servants. Therefore, Lucretia was obviously the best wife. A flame of lust kindled in Sextus, who was determined to debauch Lucretia. A few days later, Sextus returned to Lucretia's house and said if she did not give in to him, that he would slit her throat and that of a slave boy and say that he caught the two of them having an affair. Scared of this threat, Lucretia gave in to Sextus's demands. Lucretia wrote to her father and husband in Ardea, telling them to come home at once with a friend. Collatinus came with his friend Brutus, yes, that Brutus. When they were home, Lucretia told the awful story to everyone. And she told everyone to swear an oath to go and get rid of the king and his evil son. And then the story goes, which is pretty horrible, then she proceeded to stab herself. Brutus drew the knife from Lucretia's body and swore vengeance on the Tarquins. And he rallied everyone in Rome against them. And they were amazed because, as you know, Brutus was known for not being so bright. But it was all a ruse. And he was a changed person and went out there and led the Romans against the king. The men took the body to the town square and inspired the men to revolt against the Tarquins. The Romans shut the gates of Rome and forced the Tarquins out of the city. Tarquinius Superbus and the two eldest sons went to exile in the Etruscan town of Carrhae, while Sextus went to Gabii, where he was assassinated. Tarquin the Proud reigned for 25 years and ended the regal period of Rome, which was lasted 244 years. Next, the city's voting by centuries elected Lucius Junius Brutus and Lucius Tarquinius Collatinus as the first two consuls of the Roman Republic. And there we go. Valete omnes, lingua latina est vita.